am incredibly excited here that in the next week we will be hosting a vision and a dream that has been on our books for a long time. Almost a year and a half ago, we created this lectureship called the Holmgren Lectureship. I met with Chuck and Carolyn Holmgren shortly before Chuck passed away, and we talked about what could be a good living legacy here at this congregation to remember the ministry and the work that both Chuck and Carolyn were involved in. And after much discernment and planning and meetings and details, we are almost there. We are almost to the promised land. And I just want to encourage you all to come to our free public lecture this Friday night, April 13th. It starts at 7 o'clock. Dr. Susan Thistlethwaite will be presenting on public theology. She'll be talking about how we go about reading scripture influences the ways in which we participate and act as Christians. It's important in this day and age when we can get a little muddled in what it means to be good people or to be good citizens or to be good community. And one of the foundational books that Susan has asked our congregation to read is a book she wrote called Occupy the Bible. And she based it on witnessing the Occupy movement as it happened in New York and in Oakland and all across the country, where she saw people who were concerned citizens about the communities that they lived in and the ways in which those communities cared for the least of these. And those individuals came together and advocated for change, for policy change, for community change, and they tried their best to live into a way of community that helped them grow and model what it meant for them to be good people, good citizens. Susan says that this is actually a good way of modeling what happened in the early Christian church. Right after Jesus' resurrection and visit to the disciples and to the doubting Thomas, the Christians came together in these makeshift communities. They lived in tents. They went out and proclaimed the word of God. They shared the stories of Jesus. They had common possessions, a universal purse in which everyone gave and everyone who had any need were cared for. So while the modern day Occupy movement isn't necessarily exactly the same as the early Christian church, it does bear some resemblance. And it causes us as modern day Christians to take a look at the ways in which we can advocate for the communities that we want to live in. The ways in which we can advocate for the kingdom of God to be here and now among us. I always thought that I was a really good, sharp person, that I was a good human being. And, you know, why wouldn't I? I grew up in a good household and a great community. My family really didn't struggle for a lot of things. And I thought that I knew what it meant to be inclusive and generous and kind. I thought I had a good grasp on diversity, that I knew what other cultures were like. And as I reached the peak of my early childhood when I graduated high school, I thought I knew everything in the world, right? And then I went to college. And then I went out into the world. Then I got a job. And I had to work hard. I was out on my own. I discovered that for all my belief that I knew what I was doing, for all that certainty that I had built up over time, for all that faith in myself, I quickly discovered that I didn't have it all together. College is hard and difficult, and out in the world on your own, you're not always sure about what the right road to take is, or what the right task or solution to a problem is. And so I found myself having ventured out to college and the real world, returning over and over again to the faith of my childhood. I was looking for something that could ground me in the world so that I wouldn't lose myself, something that would help me grow so that I could become a better human being. So I went to college, and I thought, hey, you know, I'm in a big college town, a big university. I grew up in a very small mountain town. And so being in a big college town was very different. There were lots of new people and a diversity of faiths and religions and cultures. And I used to work for the college football team, and there were some black football players that I got to know, and I would consider myself, oh, I have some black friends. I know what it means to be racially inclusive now. you know, that was another building up of those certainties or that faith in myself that I was growing and learning. I started to be more engaged in our church, and I was a youth director. I helped out with the middle school youth group, and all of a sudden I was like, ah, now I know what it takes to raise kids. Now I know what it means to be a parent. You know, I was so sure of myself. And as I completed more and more assignments, I was like, oh, I'm a great writer. I know how to get an A in my public speaking class, or I know how to tear apart an argument in my philosophy class and talk about these different things. And when I graduated college, I did a study abroad semester and went to Europe. And that last semester of college helped me tear down some of those confidences that I had built up, some of those certainties that I had built up. I was in a different part of the world. I was in Italy and London. I went to all over the United Kingdom. I went to Spain. I was in Austria. And then I took a spring break trip to have some fun to Egypt. We thought it would be great for a couple of us to get some plane tickets and fly down and see the pyramids of Giza and the Sphinx. And we're like, oh, this would be great. I remember we flew in and arrived late at night, and it was dark outside. And we walked out of the airport, and there were army guards with assault rifles standing on the side of the road hailing taxi cabs for us. And that was kind of the first shake, rude awakening, breaking down my confidence and my certainties that I knew what I was doing. We got into this taxi cab. We had to negotiate the price of the taxi before we got into the cab. We had to agree upon a price, because if we didn't, we were told we would get to our destination and they would take any of the cash that we had on us. They would give us an extraordinary amount that we probably didn't have. So we negotiated, we got in the cab. And as we're driving through the city of Cairo to get to our hotel room, we were on this big freeway, and there were lots of cars, and it was dark out, so you couldn't see much other than 20 or 30 feet off the side of the roads. But they had big street lights that were as tall as the lights in our sanctuary here. And below the street lights were big piles of trash. Halfway up the walls of our sanctuary, all along the freeway. Piles and piles and piles of, and then beyond that trash, half-finished buildings. And all of a sudden, as we were passing by these streetlights and these piles of trash, I saw a movement on the side of the road, on the trash. And as we slowed down to take an exit, I saw what was moving. It was children. In the middle of the night, combing through the piles of trash to get supplies, to get food, to get something that they could piece together to perhaps sell. And I remember how my heart broke open. I was supposed to be on a fun spring break trip, right? Like we were gonna go see some pyramids and have fun and see the world. And I couldn't stop thinking about those kids digging through the trash. And the next day and following days, as we went out and we saw the pyramids and we went inside of them, I was awoken to the poverty of the world. I had never truly been in what I would consider a third world country, but this was it. When I returned after my spring break trip, I saw the world differently. I realized how luxurious it is that I live, how I don't have great needs in my life like those kids that I saw. After I graduated, I really felt called to go into ministry and seek how to be a better human being. See, I know what it takes to be a better human being. You know, in Micah, in the Old Testament, it says to do justice, love kindness, walk humbly with God. If I could do those things, I could be a better human being. Jesus says to love one another and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. And boy, if I could just do that, I could be a better human being. Jesus says if we love God with all our heart, soul, and mind, this would make us a better human being. And boy, I want to be a better human being. I know I do good stuff. But then I realize how much I put faith in myself and not faith in the work of God and the work of grace and mercy in this world. See, it's not enough to just give some money here and there. It's not enough to just help out someone on the street who's hungry for a meal. There are great injustices in this world. And I could make sandwiches and give them away to kids who are climbing through these piles of trash in Cairo, Egypt for the rest of my life. But I would never fix the problem of poverty and hunger. This is a systemic issue. And Susan Thistlethwaite would call this evil. This is real evil in the world, in which we live in a country that is so incredibly wealthy, it is beyond our means of comprehension. And there are people in this world who don't have a place to lay their head at night. And they work at midnight, combing through the trash, just to get by. Mm-hmm. I don't say these things to say shame on us for having the things that we have, but I say these things because these are the things that Jesus wants us to pay attention to and listen to. Jesus needs for us to be the church here and now. And that's not always easy. When I arrived at seminary, I discovered very quickly how wrong I was that I was this liberal, progressive, inclusive guy. I was like, I have black friends. I used to work for the football team. And I didn't know any of their names. I didn't know who their parents were. I didn't understand what struggles they had in life. And in seminary, I really did meet some people who just opened my eyes to the world, people that I consider good and true friends, people from the south side of Chicago who grew up in a real violent area, people who did struggle and wanted for a better life. I met people from Korea and from Cambodia and from all over the world who wanted to study the Word of God because they understood that it was something that would change the way the world is. Not just making a sandwich kind of change or putting your pocket change in the offering plate kind of change, but changing the world into the kingdom of the living, risen God. Susan Thistlethwaite is going to help us understand how we better do that. I remember sitting in her liberation theology class. You see, Susan was my academic advisor and a professor that I took multiple courses from. So it's a wonderful honor to have her come here and speak to all of you. I was a quiet, shy guy in the back of the class. I really wasn't as vocal as I am in front of you today. But I was trying to pay attention. I was trying to learn what I needed to learn so that I could be a better human being. And one day, one of our classmates who was black, was the target of some racist material that was being posted up around the seminary. Some people who were targeting her and demeaning her. And I remember we were having a class conversation about how to go about addressing this issue. This was a class on liberation theology, and we were trying to practice what it meant to liberate someone who was being oppressed. And here was this classmate of ours who was being targeted and oppressed for racism. And so the class was talking about ways that they could push back or demonstrate a better way to love God and to love our neighbors and to love those who are different from ourselves. And they were talking about donating money to Ghana or doing a fundraiser or something like that. And I remember sitting there thinking like, no, you know, we need to say something and stand up for our classmate and to push back against those racist comments. And so I raised my hand and I said, you know, this is what I'm thinking would be really helpful to do. And if we could get that published in our student magazine, if we could get our dean of the school to push this out there, if we put posters up that pushed back and argued against that mean, hateful spirit that was abiding in the classroom and in the seminary, then we could do something that would really advocate for change. We would demonstrate that we're not going to take this line down. So the class did that. And I remember Susan pulling me aside. Susan Thistlethwaite said, you know, Jeff, I had my doubts about you. You were really quiet. You weren't saying much. I wasn't sure that you were getting what we're trying to talk about here for liberation theology. And then you raised your hand. And then you said something. And you spoke out of a place of seeing the world for what it is and knowing that the world could be better, that we can all be better human beings by standing up for and with each other. Susan still talks about this to this day. I was just on the phone with her last week and she brought that up again, and I was like, yeah, you know, being a good human being isn't always easy. There are times where we fail and we struggle. But Jesus is the one who appears before us. And a black seminary student colleague who's being bullied, harassed, and the target of racism. Jesus shows up for us as children climbing through piles of trash in the middle of the night. Jesus shows up as a neighbor who is poor and doesn't have electricity in their home and is struggling to make the ends meet and pay the bills. Jesus shows up all around us. And it's our job to pay attention to where Jesus is showing up and to say something. In Susan's book, hashtag Occupy the Bible, she lifts up several ways that we can go about transforming this world. How do we go about occupying this resurrection? It's not enough to just say, oh yeah, the resurrection happened. I saw Jesus. But it has to have a drive inside of us that pushes us out into the world to go and do something. She says that, first of all, it's important that we go to the scripture, that we read the Bible prayerfully and earnestly, that we seek out what it says in the Bible, and we try to get back to the basics, understand what it is that God is trying to have us hear this day and age. The second thing is that we need to walk. We need to get out on the streets. For all the confidence that we have, all the assuredness that we believe that we know the right way about doing things, our perspective changes when we go out on the street and we wait at the bus stops with those who have to take the bus everywhere in town. When we wait in line at the soup kitchen and are served and sit down at a table with someone who's struggling to get by day, our perspective changes when we go to the broken down parts of our city. Our perspective changes when we open up a rescue shelter for those whose homes were caught on fire last week. They had to flee from the flames in southern Grand Junction. To understand that there were 10 people living in a house That house is now burned down and there's nothing that is left for them. And there are 10 people who are now homeless. Our perspective about the kingdom of God and what we are called to do is different when we get out on the streets and we walk. Thirdly, it is important for us to speak up, to talk, to say what it is that we believe, to say what is important, to be a voice for our faith. Susan really encourages us to not be afraid of using social media to advocate for the change that we want to see in this world, to get on Twitter, to get on Facebook, to share what it is that we really believe as Christians. And four, it's to connect. We need community. And we don't just need any community, we need a community that is diverse and includes everyone. Because sometimes we don't see a perspective that another person has, and we need to hear that perspective. I didn't understand the racism of the world. I didn't understand the sexism of the world. I didn't understand the homophobia of the world until I got into communities in which it was clearly demonstrated to me what that woundedness is, what that struggle is, what that evil of the world is. Like a doubting Thomas who finally was able to reach out and touch a living Christ, I've had those moments in my life where I'm connecting with something that I would say is the kingdom of God made real. And it encourages me to go out into the world and to keep doing the work of God. And every time that I get assured of myself that I know exactly what this world needs, or I am so faithful in me, it's time for me to go back and reevaluate what it is I am doing. To remember that it's really good to doubt. Doubt yourself in a way that turns you towards a risen Christ, that shows you a better way in the world, that can help you become a better human being. In fact, I think that's what we all want and need in these days, when there's lots of bickering in our politics, when there's lots of shaming in our communities, when there's a lot of struggle going on the streets. We all need to have better human beings in our lives, and we all need to be better human beings. And the work is never done. So let us not just say we know what the resurrection is. Let's go and live a resurrection. Let us be a resurrected people, always seeking the living Christ who's out there among us. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Let us turn to sing